It's like oddly beautiful, almost kind of like an art project.
Tens of millions of dollars, but it doesn't really do anything yet.
That's got to look so goofy, everybody driving past this every single day.
In 2022, Oklahoma started building these towering vertical columns for new freeway interchange ramps.
I know Oklahoma loves their football, but that's a pretty expensive goalpost. Hey, let's go make a field goal. Oh, no.
But as fun as this seems, for the past 3 years, this is all drivers have of the multi-million dollar improvement so far.
This is actually the largest project in ODOT history from a monetary standpoint.
Why Tulsa has its own Stonehenge.
Now everybody's slamming on their brakes here. Why?
And the highway engineering behind it.
I'm trying to speed up. That guy's trying to slow down.
He's hoping to solve a problem.
So we're conflicting with each other.
With Oklahoma's unlucky four-leaf clover.
The collaborative effort that goes into a project like this, you know, you've got literally hundreds of people that work for years to get to this point.
Trapper Parks is eager to finally push this project over the finish line.
Knowing that we couldn't fund everything at once, we had intentionally broken those apart.
Interstate 44 and US 75 meet just south of downtown Tulsa at a cloverleaf interchange.
So a guy invents the idea of a cloverleaf on paper. He actually patented the thing back a little over a century ago.
When the state of New Jersey realized roundabouts just weren't compatible with high-speed freeways, they took that about-to-expire patent and actually built it. Pretty clever because it's the simplest way to connect two freeways together without there being any stop signs or stoplights.
New Jersey was opening the cloverleaf in the Great Depression when people were hot-rodding around town and cars like these that weren't exactly known for speed.
But after the war, states all over the country kept building cloverleafs, including Oklahoma.
The actual interchange itself was constructed in 1963. You know, it was primarily fields around here. So the cloverleaf was a perfect design and somewhat innovative back in the 50s and 60s.
It uses a lot of land, but again, you're out in the countryside and land is cheap.
But growing cities don't stay this way. And as Woodbridge, New Jersey surrounded the first cloverleaf, they started seeing some weird problems.
Once there's less than one car length between vehicles, there's simply no place for another vehicle to fit in.
With the bridges totally rotting out by 2006, New Jersey had enough.
I do think it's kind of telling that the very first cloverleaf got ripped out.
Oklahoma just replaced the bridges on US 75. The problem here? Tulsa's growing population.
Today during rush hour, you'll see traffic back up. You'll see people trying to jockey for spots to get on or off the highways.
Everybody needs space to merge onto a freeway before there's the next exit and people try to merge back out. And engineers try to space that out a mile and a half. I mean, at least 1 mile minimum.
Tulsa's major streets are spaced every 10 blocks or 1 mile. And that's where the exits tend to be, which gives adequate space for cars entering the freeway and exiting the freeway to weave around each other and change lanes.
On these cloverleafs, that section is measured in hundreds of feet, and that's just not enough.
The cloverleaf's looping freeway ramp dumps onto the freeway right before the next looping freeway ramp.
You have traffic trying to merge onto the mainline highway and then traffic trying to merge off of the mainline highway, and a lot of crashes occur, especially with increased traffic volumes.
Weaving sections are a demolition derby as people try to figure out who's going to speed up and who's going to slow down. And that leads to a lot of sideswipe crashes.
Well, that guy wants in. See, now we're fighting each other. Okay, he wants through. All right. Pretty aggressive. You kind of have to be aggressive to be able to get into these weaving sections.
And a cloverleaf doesn't just have one of these. It has four weaving sections. There's one in between each of the four loop ramps.
Now everybody's slamming on their brakes here. Why? Well, that's because the other loop ramp is all jammed up.
And quite often, one clogged up loop ramp just backs into the next one.
And that's how cloverleafs become congestion machines.
And it gets worse. Traffic doesn't just bog down for people changing freeways.
I'm a driver who's not even trying to use the cloverleaf. I just want to drive straight through.
The traffic jam of the weaving section starts to infect the rest of the freeway.
Because everybody's slowing down in the right lane to deal with the cloverleaf. So then they start changing lanes and getting over into the left lane, and eventually all the lanes slow down. And so we're all crawling along at 10 miles an hour here, just trying to scooch through.
Once you start exceeding the capacity of those cloverleafs, it really impacts the capacity on your main line because those outside lanes are slowing down either to get over, to get off the highway, or let people get on the highway. And that impacts all lanes once that starts happening.
The cheapest fix to help deal with that is a barrier.
So to keep that traffic from splashing out into the other lanes and ruining the through traffic here, you can build a collector distributor road, put up a wall between this outside freeway lane and the rest of the freeway lane. So that way all our merging and weaving here only affects us. It doesn't affect everybody else.
So as we all try to merge our way through the weaving section, we're only focused on a couple of lanes here instead of worrying about the entire freeway.
So I'm not going to suddenly have somebody two lanes over dart over in front of me to try to grab the exit, right?
But even when traffic conditions are lighter and you can use the freeway interchange at full speed, that's still pretty darn slow on those loop ramps.
A guy like this with a pickup truck load full of furniture, he's got to go really slow around these corners. Careful merging over, don't lose the piano.
We do have some that approach those too fast and they'll leave the roadway and hit the guardrail or other obstacle outside the roadway.
Even a regular car, you can start pushing the envelope real easy. I'm not even doing 40. You can start hearing the tires give out. Look, that guardrail's all smashed up there. If a cloverleaf is a challenge to navigate for you and me in a regular car, well, what about that guy?
Interstate highways carry a lot of freight, and these vehicles, and they're barely into double-digit speeds to make it around these loop ramps.
To make this turn with a design speed of 20 miles per hour, you need a circle that's circumference is about like 600 or 700 feet. Want to up it to just 25 miles an hour? You're at 1,000 feet. And it just keeps going up and up from there.
But the real fun starts when Oklahoma decided to fix it. This video is not sponsored by
Rise,
Shallow,
Legend,
the free-to-play RPG that becomes a lot more fun when you start treating it like a store instead of a game. Out now on iPhone, Android, and Palm OS, for some reason. With traffic every day, Oklahoma had a cloverleaf to fix.
Here's one way to solve it. Just build a bridge over that weaving section so the traffic trying to get on the freeway goes over the traffic trying to go off the freeway underneath.
Engineers call these braided ramps. This one's on US 169 in Tulsa. States all over the country built these when on and off ramps get too close together. But to really fix it, they'd have to build three more braids.
If you're gonna go to this much trouble, maybe you might just be better off building a new interchange entirely.
And that's exactly what Oklahoma planned to do here at US 75.
The discussions about this started in the early to mid 90s.
The state went through the whole environmental review process a big project like this requires, held a whole bunch of public meetings, got it all approved by 2002. But construction didn't start for another 18 years because that's how long it took to start getting enough money together to even get started. In fact, they had to break the project up into five smaller pieces.
Starting with replacing overpasses and winding Interstate 44, eventually working their way up to replacing three of the loop ramps with big flyovers.
So our work package one included the widening of I-44 right in the footprint of the interchange.
And pavement on an interstate highway with a lot of trucks is a lot more expensive than you might think.
You know, 14 inches of concrete pavement that have dowel steel reinforcement in it. And then below that is 3 inches of asphalt. And then below the asphalt is 8 inches of aggregate base, which is similar to what we're standing on here, an angular type gravel. And then below that is 8 inches of chemically stabilized subgrade. So it's a very thick paving section that when you're driving over the surface, you may not realize, you know, what's below you.
In some of the more exciting work packages, they want to get rid of three of the four loop ramps, which eliminates all the weaving sections. Put the traffic instead on big flyover bridges, which merge the traffic in far outside the interchange area.
Instead of having traffic getting off and getting on in a very short distance, you have an actual ramp that is dedicated to each movement, and you have plenty of merging room where those ramps tie into the new mainline highway.
And a flyover ramp is probably one of the most complicated and expensive parts of a freeway.
I can see Tulsa residents getting stuck in the same traffic right here every day and going, oh, come on, it's half finished, just build it.
But this plan set can show you why it's so expensive to build.
Two design firms that are working to make elevations meet up exactly.
So a few years ago in Oklahoma, definitely did not yet have the money to build these ramps, a chance to save a little money popped up during highway widening and work package number one.
So we had the contractor on site.
And while working to fix up a different bridge.
So you'll see all these existing piers. We had those done as part of work package one, knowing we weren't going to use them at that time.
The widening project was juggling traffic around so much, it seemed like a good time to build the vertical piers, especially the ones right in the middle of the freeway.
And so had they not been constructed on the original project, we would have had to come back, shift traffic, get them out of the way.
A clever use of construction staging, even if it means the rest of us are poking fun at the way it currently looks.
before the design ever starts, you have a lot of data collection, like the survey part of that, collecting every piece of information topographically, utilities, the existing infrastructure to acquire right away.
Because the freeway ramps now land far outside the interchange, there was some buyouts of buildings along Interstate 44 here.
Not too many buildings were in the way. There used to be about six or eight houses here. With the magic of Google Street View, I've made reappear.
And the ramp itself? Well, just imagine a minute having to build a building that's strong enough to hold a bunch of semi-trucks and cars all at the same time, 50 feet up in the air for a quarter of a mile. They were feeling pretty lucky if they could even get one of these ramps built at a time.
This current work includes three work packages, which originally was going to happen at three different times. We were very fortunate to receive some large grants, federal grants for this project.
And that's a big deal here. Oklahoma state gas tax is only like 19 cents a gallon. I know back home, I think I pay 69 cents a gallon. So there's not a lot of money for a big highway project like this. But we pay a federal gas tax too, and although that hasn't gone up since 1994 and the pot of money is shrinking with inflation each year, it does give a lot of money for a project like this if Oklahoma can win a competitive federal grant. And they did.
And just in time. Post-pandemic inflation has been clobbering road construction projects.
We've seen nearly 60% increase in our major pay item construction costs in about the last 4 years. Today, it's the largest monetary value project that we've ever had.
With federal money in the account, contractors are back at work. First, finishing up the remaining piers that need to be built.
These piers you see standing below the ground, we have at least 25, and in these cases, sometimes 30 feet of what we call the drilled shaft that goes below the ground.
With a structure this big, they really want to make sure they attach it to lots of bedrock.
Making sure we're not going to have any settlement, because a house can withstand a little bit of settlement. It's not good on bridges.
Contractors use a giant machine like this, attached to a giant drill bit like this, to dig a hole in the ground.
And then they will insert a casing into that hole.
These thick pieces of steel keep the dirt from falling back in. And these thinner tubes act like a liner between the concrete and the steel, so that way when it's all cured, they can get the big steel pieces back out. The concrete they pour in the hole surrounds this.
A cage of rebar, reinforcing steel.
Rebar at the top of the column ties into the steel for the pier cap, which crews pour inside these temporary forms.
They had to do some pedestal work where our beams will actually set on top of these existing piers.
More temporary forms serving as the feet where I-beams or precast concrete girders will sit. In between, this neoprene load bearing pad.
It's this big block right here that the I-beam sits on that he says allows it to move back and forth as it gets hot and cold without things cracking up. Chemical engineers are getting pretty good at the job because Trapper says this should last the life of the bridge, like 75 years.
We'll start setting beams, hopefully before the 4th of July. You know, the cranes lifting the beams up and setting them into place on those piers.
A couple of years ago, we got to go on a tour of a construction site in California where they were building a big flyover ramp like this with a box girder design. It's a little bit different than this. And in California, they were designing it for an earthquake. Well, this is Oklahoma, so I asked Trapper, what's the natural disaster you're planning for when you're building one of these?
He tells me they don't design for tornadoes per se, but wind is a pretty big deal in the Midwest.
The biggest risk is during construction, making sure your beams that are up there are secured, any objects that can be blown away with a heavy wind, making sure all that stuff is secured and tied down.
He says flooding is the bigger issue.
Making sure you have no equipment or other things that are in some of the floodways that come through the area.
So let's see here, they've dug the footings, they built the piers, they put the pier caps on top, they put the I-beams in place. Well, what's left? I guess the concrete that we need to drive on.
They will place some stay-in-place forms on those beams.
So if you look up there, you can see corrugated steel. Well, that's because when they go to pour the concrete, without it, it would just all drip to the ground. And so this way, it gives it a place to cure. And then once it's all dry, well, they leave it up there as part of the structure.
And then they'll put the reinforcing steel on top of that.
Rebar reinforcement to make the concrete extra strong.
And then they'll pour the concrete that will set on those forms.
The gentle curve of the final ramp is designed for speed.
Engineers put a bank on these ramps side to side, kind of like a racetrack. That helps the water run off when it rains. Also helps cars keep moving.
If you look closely at some of those down there, you can see some of the super elevation, the way that they're tilted.
You don't have an enormous lean in Oklahoma like you might see in warm weather states, but it still helps.
It'll be much, much higher than what the Cloverleaf ramps are.
We're talking quite a bit about keeping cars moving in this video, but what about everybody else? Well, if I wanted to walk from this neighborhood over to a perfectly good grocery store over there to get groceries, I can't because 51st Street dead ends because the big looping ramps for the Cloverleaf are in the way. They've been that way since the 1950s. But if you spend the money right on an enormous car project like this, you can make it better for everybody.
Connection will go right where the north loops are now. Yes, so it'll go under US 75. And that was one of the things that we were awarded the $10 million raise grant for, was that reconnection of 51st Street.
And a little farther to the east.
And it'll also include a pedestrian bridge over the railroad, which right now they cannot cross.
One of those old bridges that to a 1950s engineer, they said, yeah, it's fine. He has physical space to walk across the railroad bridge. But an engineer today would go, oh yeah, this needs to be better.
This is a project that Tulsa has been eagerly waiting for.
That billboard's way up high. I think they're anticipating the flyover ramps being done.
Our legislative delegation has been a huge supporter of this, and we're thankful for that. So we expect, when all is said and done, to be in the $400 million range to complete the entire five work packages.
From the plains to the Piedmont, this is the Summer of the Southeast, where I take you across several different states here, and it's made possible exclusively thanks to people like you paying a few pennies at patreon.com/roadguyrob. And yes, I wrote that without ChatGPT. Thank you very much.